I don't know if they were going to introduce me or not, but these people up here say, just go ahead and introduce yourself. So I guess that's what I'll do. I am the speaker tonight, Fred Barkey, okay?
Sir Fred.
Sir Fred, that's my comrade reminded me. And I'm so gratified to see so many people out here. What it puts me in mind of is my father, we came from Pennsylvania down here back in the 1950s. And one of the things my dad always used to say is, one of the things about West Virginia, wonderful place, wonderful people, and so on and so forth, but they really need more entertainment. And tonight's outpouring is a validation of that observation, it seems to me. You know, he said they need a zoo, they need, you know, a huge amusement park, not Camden Park, is a kind of rinky-dink thing. But I think that's true. Also, it's okay for all you older people, but if there are any young, impressionable people, I think we ought to have caution about the material they're going to hear tonight, that it may destroy them or poison their minds. So you can send them down to Wendy's and get a chocolate frosty for a while when we're dealing with this program. Okay. I don't know if I didn't get to read Paul Niden's little write-up in the paper, but I think maybe he gave you the title of the talk tonight, which is we never had any of this stuff around here. And so that's the main title. And we wish we didn't, or something to that effect. So I'm going to try tonight to talk about the subject of the Socialist Party in West Virginia from about 1898 to approximately 1920. But it's not going to be a real history of the party or anything. It's going to be an attempt to kind of give you a feel for what this was like back in the day, as it were. And I hope that will pique your interest so that you can buy the book that was just published in April by the West Virginia University Press. Actually, it was my dissertation, which I never did get published, although all kinds of people seem to want to, but this never happened. So we expect these to fly off the shelves as a result of these kinds of meetings. The only problem is, or the big problem is, that one of the drawbacks of someone that delves into movements like this, into the Communist Party, let us say, or the Socialist Party, or the syndicalists in American history, or what have you, in other words, pretty far left in the spectrum. One of the problems with that is that it's a difficult situation for you when you do that. I didn't realize it at the time, to be frank about it. I really did it because I was curious about it. Nothing particularly in my background. My father was a white collar worker for the Gulf Oil Company in Pittsburgh. My mother's brothers and so on were all steel workers up the Monongahela River Valley. Many of them good union people with the United Steelworkers of America, etc. And I certainly put a lot of store in them. But you know, nothing really very pointedly that would lead me in that direction. But in the 70s, there was a kind of a flurry of looking at the Socialist Party throughout the country. And of course, I jumped right in on it, you know, being fairly naive. Now, this did not surprise my parents one bit. Not one bit. And I'll tell you why I think that's true. I went to a school up there, a grade school, which is now gone, called Shakespeare School. And one of the things that Shakespeare School did every year was to put out a newspaper by students. I think that's a very good thing, actually. And so they got a committee of students together, the teachers that were going to put out the paper did, and they asked them, said, we need an editor for the paper, and we would like it if you'd be here to choose the editor of the paper. Well, guess who they chose? I have no idea why they chose me, except that one of the committee lived two doors from me. And one, another one, a girl, Shirley Young, she's dead. And another one was Virginia, a girl named Virginia Pfluger. Years and years later in Pittsburgh, we had a reunion. She came up and told me, she said, I have something I want to tell you, and I've been meaning to tell you for a long, long time. And I said, well, what is it, Virginia? She said, I had a crush on you in grade school. I really hate it when some woman comes up and says something. It's so rare, number one, that that happens. But then, when you really can't do anything about it, it's even more frightening. So, I was elected to be, by my peers, which I was flattered about that, to be the editor. Well, apparently what happens is the editor had only one duty, and that was to do an editorial, because they only put out one copy of the Shakespeare Times. So I had to think about what I was going to write on. Now this is, you know, in the sixth grade, okay? And I decided that I would write about the Chinese communists and the long march of Mao to the interior of the country. Where the hell I got that? I do not know, but I knew that, and that seemed rather fascinating to me, rather heroic to me, and I wanted to find out something about it. Well, it caused the biggest hullabaloo that you can possibly imagine. My parents had to come in, and my mother said, well, they said, he wants to write about the Chinese communism, Mrs. Barkey. We're just not sure whether we can have that. Now, this is before the whole McCarthy business and the real Cold War, and I hope you appreciate that. And we just don't know what to do about it. And so they came home and said, now, why don't you pick something else? I'm Irish, mostly Irish by extraction from Killarney in Ireland, the Stevensons came from. And what happened there was then they got my Irish up. I said, no way, I want to do the Chinese communist business. And so I wrote an editorial, about a half a page long, on the Chinese communists. So what I'm saying to you is, I really didn't realize at the time, but now I do, that I was preordained. See, the magic hand was involved in this to get me involved in this stuff. Well, it's sort of always been that way. And one of the things I experienced after doing this work was, every once in a while, somebody would get wind of the fact that I had done this kind of research. Usually it comes during a coal strike or maybe a political campaign or something of that ilk. And so a reporter will come to see me. Almost invariably, and I kid you not, almost invariably when I do that, I get phone calls about it after the fact. For example, not too long ago, not that many years ago anyway, I had a meeting with a Gazette reporter who came to talk about this very issue. And of course he wrote up an article in the Gazette about it. No sooner did that paper hit the streets than I got an irate phone call from an old gentleman up in East Bank. I can't recall his name right now, and probably wouldn't tell you if I did know, but what he was upset about was that in this interview with the reporter, I mentioned he wanted to know about the Socialist Party, its involvement with the UMWA, and so on and so forth. And I mentioned the fact that in 1912, the Socialist Party was swept into office in the Cabin Creek, Pain Creek mine district of Kanawha County. And that all the local officers, therefore, in the county were socialists. And therefore, it was really socialists by 1913 who supervised the construction of East Bank High School, where this gentleman went to school, where my wife went to school, where a lot of my friends went to school. Okay? And he said, where did you get such a crazy idea as that? I mean, this man, I'm understating the case. This man was furious. He was really furious. He said, where in the heck did you get that? That's crazy talk. So I said, well, let me ask you this. Did you know, did you ever know or hear of Silas Nance, Brad Scott, John Julio Bannister, T.L. Doc Tincher, or any of those fellows? And he admitted, he said, well, I knew a couple of them and I'd heard of some of the others. I said, well, they were all socialists. And if you would like, I can show you some documents here at the house which would help to credentialize them as such. And I said, furthermore, if you would like to come down here, I have election returns from the election of 1912, and I can show you where they were elected into office. Well, he never did show up. I wish I still had his phone number because I could call him and say, look for $29.95 one of these books, and he'll tell you everything pretty much that you were curious about, okay? So, you know, what I'm trying to do tonight is to, I want to say, is to try to give you, as I mentioned, a little bit of insight into the Socialist Party. From about the turn of the last century to about the time of the First World War, actually, which is their heyday here in West Virginia. And I want to make four or five points. I hope I have enough time to do it. When I used to teach different subjects like progressivism and some labor stuff and what have you, my students would really get into panic sometime because I would, period after period after period, I would talk about it and it began finally to grate on their nerves and drive them crazy. And one of my colleagues picked up one of my students one time, didn't know it was one of my students, and to give him the ride, I was teaching at Morris Harvey UC at that time. Carol Campbell will remember those days, I expect. He's noticed that they had one of the books that I used in class, and he said, well, where are you in your recent American history course? And this was towards the end of the semester, and I think we were up to the Second World War. You know, it's going 1900 to the present, yeah, that kind of thing. And so the instructor said, well, my goodness, you ought to be much further along down the road, you know, to the end of the, right up to date and than that. What do you think's the problem? He said, I love this retort that the student gave. He said, well, mister, it seems there were these progressives. And there were, and there were, and there were, and there were. Okay. All right. So I just revised the course time chronology and usually end with the Second World War. Okay. Well, one point I want to make is that if you live during this period, the chances are really quite good that if you even made half an effort, you could read socialist newspapers. Right? You could read them. They cover the state from north to south. And I'd like to list a few of them so that you can, you know, really brag about this and say to people that you might meet on the street or wherever, you could say, say, fella, do you, lady, do you happen to know, can you name six socialist newspapers that published from 1900 to 1914, and if they can't, you can just rattle them off. Well, there was blah, 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 blah. All right. The first socialist newspaper to be established in West Virginia, as far as I know, was a paper called The Social Rebel. The Social Rebel was published actually over in Ohio, in Marietta, Ohio, in a plant that had been taken over by a printers union after a strike, which I thought was quite interesting. And so they published this paper. These papers, by the way, are all weekly papers. All right. And the gentleman who published this paper was a native-born Parkersburgian, is that how you'd say it, or Parkersburger? By the name of Frederick Fritz Merrick. Merrick was from a very good family there. His father was Charles Merrick. Charles Merrick was a lawyer, a very active devotee of the Prohibition Party in West Virginia, and just a well-known civic-minded kind of individual, along with his wife. They were both very dedicated to improving Parkersburg. How Fritz became a socialist, I do not know. I think it was in college, but he went away to college and came back. One fellow who casually knew him said, he came back a red. Okay, that's good. Merrick was one of the most dedicated people I've ever read about and was involved in this kind of work. And is probably the most important radical that was ever produced in West Virginia, but little is known about him. About 1908, he moved to Pittsburgh, running away actually from some libel cases that had a continuous life seemingly of their own. He's always being dragged into court for libel. And one of the main reasons is that he really upset the apple cart. He actually was a tremendous investigative reporter and exposed some of the biggest business deals as being extremely corrupt and what have you down that way. So he went up to Pittsburgh and he edited a paper called The Justice, the Pittsburgh Justice, which is one of the two big socialist newspapers in the country. The Social Rebel then ran from about that 1904 period to about when Fritz left, maybe a year or two after that. One of the things that really got me about Fritz Merrick is that he probably knew about as much law as the lawyers who were prosecuting him. And he was a part and parcel of his own defense. He had an excellent lawyer, a fellow by the name of Conniff, who came from Wheeling and was a person who did a lot of cases involving the Socialist Party. I'm just telling you all kinds of stuff. Now, there's no charge for this. You don't know what I'm saying, so. The second paper I call your attention to is the one right here in Charleston. It's called The Labor Argus. And The Labor Argus was originally owned by two brothers, two printers by the name of Snyder, Alvin Snyder and his brother. They eventually went to work for the Daily Mail and put out that newspaper, but originally they were the editors and publishers of the Charleston Labor Argus. The Labor Argus was taken over, purchased really, in 1910 by two ex-Virginia tobacco growers, the Boswell brothers, Charles Boswell and his brother. And they operated right out of Virginia Street about 607. You can go down there and see the building is still there, I believe, where they operated. They had owned a small furniture business here in Charleston. And they were extremely active and excellent journalists. The third paper that I will call your attention to is the Huntington Socialist Star. And it was organized by the local socialist group down in Huntington, consisting mainly of machinists from the C&O shop, which wasn't too far from their headquarters. Their headquarters, by the way, and their publishing house was on 7th Avenue, which, if you know Huntington very well, was that avenue right by the railroad there as you head towards River Park. When I was a freshman, I lived in upstairs of an upholstery shop right there, but I didn't know that I was living such a historic socialist headquarters, or I probably would have gone down there and taken a picture of it. Okay. The man who was picked to be the editor there, oh, by the way, also the pottery workers were involved in that, and the key person there is a fellow by the name of Edwin Firth, who was a foreman at the Wiley This is for Karen.
Wiley China Factory.
So that you can go back down there in Huntington and tell them you know something that they don't know about. Edwin Firth, very active guy, and by the way, eventually died in federal prison, being that he was scooped up in the Red Scare raid of the early 1920s and could not get out and got sick and passed away there. Also, the Gillespie brothers, who were machinists, the pea person, who was raised up here on the north side of the Kanawha River, right around Shrewsbury and Glasgow and so on, a fellow by the name of Wyatt Thompson. Thompson, you will see if you read through this period on labor issues and what have you, involved in practically everything. He was involved in the Paint Creek, Cabin Creek strike. His paper and the Argus were closed and the press is destroyed by Governor Henry Hatfield to quiet them down so that the strike of Paint Creek and Cabin Creek could be settled. He actually edited both papers, so when they tried to push them together, which they eventually did around 1915, 1916, so it was the Argus Star. Just to show you what I'm talking about, I was talking to a Pulitzer Prize winning journalist, Eric Newhouse, not too long ago, who was doing an article for the American Bar Association annual journal. I call it to your attention because it's got interesting, it's got my picture in it. That's one of the main reasons I'm calling your attention to it. Terrible picture, by the way. But I think it looks just like me, which is kind of a problem. By the way, speaking of Huntington, you know Matt Gillenwater teaches down in, or is retired, but taught down at Marshall, don't you, Karen?
Yeah, he's in geography.
Geography, yeah. And he's a good friend of mine, and some years ago, we both agreed that we were getting so old and so ugly that we would try to limit our public appearances as much as possible. And he's kept up with that, and I unwisely have not. In these two articles, and I think you would enjoy them, because they really review a lot of the labor problems, King Cole's Violent Reign, one article, and then the next one is the, which I think is the better article of the two, is State Courts and the Strikes. I highly recommend that to you. It pulls together some really interesting stuff about how the courts come down on labor and so on in this time period. But in here he says, he talks about the Argus, he talks about the Star, and he said they were socialist-leaning newspapers. I just got so upset about that. See what happens to you. And you don't get more socialist than the Huntington Socialists and Labor Stars, okay? So they were not leaning, they were already collapsed over into that business. Okay. I actually interviewed Wyatt Thompson. I tracked him down over into Columbus, Ohio, where he lived. And he was quite ill. I'm the only one that ever talked to him. Really great guy. The reason he was over in Columbus, this is in the late 60s, the reason he was over there was that in the 1920s, during Prohibition, he had, in desperation, turned to moonshining. And they caught him, okay, the federal people did. And they tried him and convicted him and so on. And they sentenced him to the worst punishment that you can give, that you can mete out in the courts to a native West Virginian. Does anybody know what that is? Do you know what that is? No, that would be easy time. What?
Oh, didn't find him.
No, that's correct. Confine them to Ohio. And that's what happened to him. They said, we're not going to put you in jail, but we are going to exile you to Ohio, and you've got to promise never to set foot again in the sovereign state of West Virginia. And he was good with that. I mean, he did it, but he actually wept a little bit when he said, "No, I can't go back." I said, "Well, did you ever try to go back?" "No, I just couldn't do it." And I felt like a ghoul because they were coming shortly to pick him up and take him to a hospital because he was really having an episode of whatever it was that was bothering him. I eventually killed him, I guess. And yet he wanted to tell his story. And it's the only time I've ever interviewed anybody and walked along with the pets on pad towards the ambulance. And they put him in the ambulance. They said, "Let that fella come in here and walk with me to the hospital." I said, "Yeah, let me come in there." And they said, "Are you real?" I said, "No, but I'm doing the story that I'm trying to immortalize this comic." So they let me do it. I just wasn't thinking. I mean, I got carried away. I got over there in the hospital in Columbus somewhere. And I thought to myself, "Hey, Fred, you don't have any way to get back to your car." And it cost me about $15 state tax credit in my car. These are the adventures of a nitwit. Another important paper was the Wheeling paper, which was the majority. The majority was actually subsidized by the Amalgamated Iron, Tin, and Steel Workers Union in Ohio County in Wheeling, which was the precursor, preceding the United Steelworkers of America. It was the old steel union, what they call the old amalgamated, okay? The editor of this paper was a printer by the name of Walter Hilton. Walter Hilton. Again, not many people, I don't know if he's in your, in our encyclopedia of West Virginia or not. But Hilton was quite a noteworthy guy, in my opinion. He was very, very influential up in the Ohio Valley Trades and General Assembly up there. And he was also an expert on Unitarianism and gave lectures and participated in symposia at Harvard University. So, you know, he was no small potatoes in a way. He was, as socialists go, he was a mild socialist, in my opinion. But his paper did help to feature that stuff. Now, in West Virginia, I call St. Albans my home, because that's where we moved when we came from Philadelphia. And I was absolutely flabbergasted to learn that St. Albans, of all places, had a socialist newspaper during this period. And what really intrigued me was the name of it, the 1919. It was funded by a socialist local there. It was edited by a lawyer by the name of Samuel Morrison. And the reason for the 1919 name was that Morrison and some of his comrades there believed firmly that the year 1919 would initiate a tremendous upheaval of the working class, not only here in the United States, but in Europe. Now, I mean, is that prophetic or is that prophetic? Okay, it's obviously prophetic, is it not? They may have been on drugs, I do not know. What's the deal there? Certainly St. Albans today is just full of drugs and what have you, but then I'm just not sure. People are invading homes in there and doing all kinds of crazy stuff. But I was fascinated with that. Also, of course, you had several short-lived papers. There was one in Clarksburg called, appropriately enough, the Clarksburg Socialist. I do not know very much about it as far as that goes. But as far as I know, we don't have any copies of it. These newspapers, by the way, would be supplemented by that what essentially was the national newspaper of the Socialist Party, and lots of people read it. It was called The Appeal to Reason. It was published in Girard, Kansas, and it had, even as early as 1909, it had 5,000 or 6,000 subscribers here in West Virginia, which I think is really quite amazing. So for, little or nothing, you could probably get a socialist newspaper and begin to follow the activities of the Socialist Party here in West Virginia. The Socialist Party itself, of course, is formed in 1901, the Socialist Party of the United States. And we are Johnny on the spot, by the way, the first chapter of the Socialist Party here in West Virginia is established in Wheeling, West Virginia, 1901, the same year the party was established. And it was the Eugene V. Debs chapter of Socialist Party of America, because he almost single-handedly got that movement kicked off out there. By the way, some of you received when you came in, and I give it to you as a souvenir, I didn't realize it'd be quite as many people, but it's a charter for the Socialist Party in Dunbar, if you can look at that carefully. Now, I mean, you seem like you're reasonable people, but I ask you, if you were asked sometime by the man on the bus or the street or at Walmart or wherever it might be, to name five cities in West Virginia, in southern West Virginia, even if you'll make it easier for them, where there would likely be a socialist chapter, how many of you would pick Dunbar? Well, that's what I thought. So I thought this only helps to illustrate my major point, is that people just don't realize that there was this movement, that it might have existed, in fact, right here in our own community. I used to teach with the present mayor of Dunbar, so I'm going to bring him one of these copies and show him that there's radical roots here, if you'll just dig around and look for them, okay? Anyway, a paper like these would certainly catch people's attention and would stimulate them to try to understand what in the world socialism was all about. Oftentimes they would have a guest editor. At the beginning of the early days, 1901, 1902, 1903, 1904, right in there, you often found articles by Debs. And I brought this campaign poster here, 1904 campaign poster of Eugene D. Debs and Mr. Harriman, so that you would see maybe what he looked like. But he is Mr. Socialist in the United States. And he had established a kind of precursor to the Socialist Party, which was called Social Democracy in America. I wish I knew more about that, because it really does kind of fascinate me. But one of the themes with the Social Democrats believed in was a vision for America. And Debs was very good about trying to establish that vision. They felt that what needed to be done here in America in this period was to establish what they called the cooperative commonwealth. The cooperative commonwealth. And you will see this a lot, or hear this a lot. Now you can see it or hear it, either one, but I guess. But in Debs's presentations, both his writings and in his speeches. And he was a spellbinder of the first order, okay? Never needed a microphone and what have you, just one of those kinds of guys. One of the things that Debs was fond of doing was to talk about why we needed this cooperative commonwealth. And what he said was, because the capitalism as it has developed here in America has ruined the culture. It has ruined the culture. And he paints this picture of what America was like before we saw this heavy-duty, oligopolistic, monopolistic, huge capitalist development. He would paint this picture, kind of almost a bucolic picture of the tradesmen of work. He would point out that everything was great back in those days. The craftsman produced at his own discretion, produced for use and not for profit, had enough power and control of his tools so that he could control to a great extent how he worked and how long he worked and how much he had time to enjoy. But what happened? In comes the machine age. In comes the, what he sometimes called the organizational technology, not just machines and what have you, but also how to organize production. And in that sense, he was kind of prophetic. Later on, with this will be the key, won't it, to money management techniques, to divide jobs down in their finest components and make sure that you get workers trained that can do this stuff and really get efficient and crank it out. Okay? So he said, what's really happened is that production has become very collectivized, very supervised, and as a result, we have lower wages, we have production that only certain people can buy, the workers cannot buy the results of their own labor, and so what we have is a few people getting richer and richer, and most people getting poorer and poorer. I don't know if this sounds familiar at all to you, but you may be able to see why there is some bit of interest in all this stuff today. Well, you know, people would read this. You would read it, perhaps, if you were in those days. And when you did, sometimes you might write to the newspaper. And what they would do when they would write to the newspaper, and I don't find this in other papers, although some of my historian friends are in here, I welcome you to critique me on this, criticize me on it, because I may be wrong. But what struck me about reading these old socialist newspapers was that people who wrote in their letters to the editor, so you know that's an old business, letters to the editor, oftentimes expressed their opinions in the form of poetry. They did not write a letter explaining, you know, what this is about and why this is good and why this is bad. They simply wrote a poem and sent it in. I love that. I thought, gee, that's really neat. And just to show you, the dips, seeds do not fall on fallow ground, okay? I have this poem, and I may have to get my magnifying glass out to read it because my eyes are so bad anymore. In fact, to tell you the truth, but half my organs don't work the way they're supposed to. And the others work overtime, I think. What happened? Just a terrible, terrible mess. But the reason I also like this, this poem was written by by a woman. She and her friend, her name was Roxy Trent. And her friend, Gertrude Johnson, both lived in a little city in Logan County called Christian, West Virginia. I don't know if you know where it is. I think it's over near Mann somewhere, Ken. I'm just not sure, but it's over there somewhere. Anyway, another thing that really interests me, I tried to track this Trent family down, and I did find them. They still are, the descendants still are over there in Logan County. And I showed them a couple poems that these ladies had written. Well, they were absolutely flabbergasted. They knew them, you know, as they were older women and perhaps in a nursing home or, you know, whatever it was. And I had a heck of a time persuading them, yeah, they really wrote this. And see, this fascinates me, that this movement and sometimes the union movement, what have you, creates these events in people's lives that they probably never suspected would happen to them. And they rise to the occasion, if you will, okay? They do. So this is a poem that she wrote into the Argus Star called Heart Up, okay? And I'll read it to you if you can bear with me. Or if you don't want it, hold up your hand. No, there we go. I can't start that. Okay. Okay. In days in which we were well off, many, many years ago, the men wore homemade trousers, mostly made of tow, T-O-W. If you know what that is, I'd like to know. I never can get anybody to tell me what it is. The most of us were farmers, and we had enough to eat. We raised all kinds of vegetables and hogs to make our meat. We were so well off, them times we now regret. But when socialism gets in power, we may be well off yet. In those days so well remembered, most of us owned our land. But to others not so fortunate, we would lend a helping hand. We'd let them have a place to live, perhaps a rocky spot, and never care much whether we collected rent or not. We were so well off, them times we now forget. But when socialism gets in office, we may be well off yet. And now we are so hard up for the want of clothes and food. I like it, I got to say food. I had a seventh grade social science teacher, Miss Falloon, who said we pronounce all these words wrong in America. We were all mixed up. We were just not phonetic enough. If G-O-O-D is good, F-O-O-D is food. Okay? That kind of thing. She was a complete nutcase. They all called me Ted. It's my nickname up there. And she just about had apoplexy. She said, "You're Frederick." I said, "Okay, but ain't gonna fly. Nobody's gonna do that." So, and now we are so hard up for the want of clothes and food, and we have to pray for water and burn coal instead of wood. Our boys work like bank mules, a living now to make. They work from sun up to sundown, as if their life was at stake. We are so hard up, we never can forget. But when socialism gets in office and power, we may be well prepared. Love the poem. Okay, this lady with very limited education, I'm sure, according to her family as well. But that's the way it went. Okay, number two. So I'm on number two and I only have 15 minutes. I don't know how that's going to work out. Okay, nobody has yet walked out, so we're at school. Another thing that is, I think, overlooked somewhat by historians, not always, but somewhat overlooked, is that the socialists were always, you know, trying to convince people, convert people to their way of thinking. And newspapers, that was fine and good and so on. But if you showed any interest in these matters, they would follow that up, most certainly, with a pamphlet. See, Pat, you might walk into you and say, "That Pat Robin, he looked like a potential convert to me. Pat, I want you to read this, if you get a chance, read this pamphlet." There's a whole series of pamphlets called Little Red Books. And they would hand them, they would buy them from the International Socialist International office. And their locals would buy them, and they as individuals would buy. I've run into quite a few of these guys who were definitely socialist organizers. Some of you may know one of them that I thought was one of the best I ever saw, and that was a fellow that had done on Randolph Street here in the West Side for many years. His name was George Glass. And he was a go-getter as far as socialism. And I went down to interview him, and he took me out to his garage. He said, "Just hold on to your hat." He said, "I want to show you something." Went in his garage, and he had built these little shelves all the way around his garage. He had every conceivable pamphlet or piece of literature you could possibly imagine. And what really enthused me about him was that I'd interview other people, like George Harper down, who lived up that road near the housing project down there. It was out towards Sissonville, you know what I mean? George Harper, who was a painter, and I said, "George, how did you become a socialist?" He said, "I can tell you real quick. It was 1908, and I just came out of the polls. You know, we had that big depression in 1907, and things were rough here in West Virginia, no matter what history or anybody else said. And I came out of there, and lo and behold, who was standing there but this guy? I didn't know who he was, but he introduced himself. He said his name was George Glass. I said, "Well, I'm George. You're George. I'm George." And he said, "I want you to read this pamphlet." I took it home and read it. And I joined the Socialist Party the next day. Amazing, okay? But what what could happen there was actually pretty amazing. And I'll give you another example, maybe the best example that I have. In 1901, the United States Steel Company up in its Benwood plant, Benwood, I believe, is in Marshall County, is it not? It's either Marshall or Ohio, but I think it's actually Marshall County. Anyway, no.
Marshall.
Marshall,
good, thank you, Marshall. Okay, up to the Benwood plant. And this fella who was working there as a foreman, a fellow by the name of Harry Leeds, was ordered by the company to fire the best puddler, you know, an iron puddler, in his crew, a man by the name of Anthony Osterman. Okay. And the reason that he was to be fired was management got wind of the fact that this guy was a rabid socialist and that he was passing out pamphlets to people in the plant. So they said to Leeds, you fire that guy. Well, what they didn't know was one of the people that he'd been passing out pamphlets to was Harry Leeds, see? And Harry Leeds never fully appreciated, I mean, he'd read him, he was a courteous guy, nice guy, he'd read him, but he never realized the real, let's say, tenuous position that workers in American industrial plants actually had until he had to supposedly follow those orders and fire Osterman. Well, he refused. So they fired him instead. And I think eventually fired Osterman, or got someone to fire Osterman. But Leeds, they don't know what they unleashed, because Leeds was one of the most active organizers that you could possibly find in Ohio County and in that upper end of West Virginia. Another thing that you will see in these pamphlets, I mean, a lot of them would focus on this very thing that affected our friend Mr. Leeds, industrial issues and problems of the day, you know, this inadequacy and unfairness and whatever they would, of the capitalistic system as it is evolving. But also the pamphlets were good to try to get across theoretical ideas of the Socialist Party, okay? And the one that you see a lot of response to, workers responding to this, evidencing that they understood it, they liked the idea, etc., etc., was what is sometimes called the labor theory of value. If you don't understand that. Anybody know what the labor theory of value is? Carol?
It's market idea.
Labor creates everything. See, if you didn't have labor, you wouldn't have anything. Capital alone will not do it. You must have labor. Things must be created, then labor is necessary. On the other hand, the theory goes, you can get rid of the capitalists and you can still produce stuff and have a quality of life because the labor is convenient. See, that's sort of the basic idea. Now, if you tell that to a dedicated capitalist, they'll say, that is the most cock and bull story I ever heard. That's just plain crazy talk. Okay? But that's the way it went. So, this fell on pretty fertile ground, and I'll read you another poem. And this one evidences the absorption of workers in this idea. This is called So Good For Us. And it goes like this. This I have to use. You see them houses with stately yards, they're sitting on the boulevards with sassy grass in front and back, and on the side an auto track. Well, you and me, we don't live there. No, we don't even own those places. Still, 'twas you and me that built them, Bill. And then there's factories that hurt your eye to look at, soaring they are so high. They grind out, so they say, a bunch of profits every day. Those machines are hardly ever still. Well, you and me, we built them, Bill. And take them engines on a track, or the streetcars running out and back. Them cranes that blocks of iron do snatch, we built the whole blame shooting match. The guy that calls them things his own, He never set a single stone. He never drove a nail nor laid a sill. 'Twas you and me that built him, Bill. The guy would write that in the newspaper, okay? And other workers would read it and say, what? Amen. Amen. That's exactly right. Okay. Third thing I want to mention, you could have read our pamphlets, you could have read the newspapers. Most important, in a way, in some way, you could have attended a public meeting. They were big on, socialists are big on public meetings. And sometimes this, of course, was during political campaigns, but more than likely, it was a regular kind of thing. A number of these guys had made commitments to speak every, say, Friday night at 6 o'clock on the corner of such and such a street, such and such a street. They'd get out a soapbox, literally, get out a stand, stand up on it, and start talking about their beliefs. You see that in London, don't you? Those little parks in London where people hold forth like that. One that was very effective with that was our friend Fritz Merritt. And just as effective was his friend, his closest friend and comrade in this kind of ongoing, regular effort. That was a man by the name of Harold Houston. Harold Houston, probably most well-known socialist in West Virginia in his day. He was eventually the lawyer for the United Mine Workers all through the Mine Wars period. Came originally from Noble County, Ohio, into Parkersburg, into Wood County. Somehow met up with Merrick, and I'm pretty well convinced that Merrick converted Houston to socialism. I can't prove it, but you don't care anyway, do you? But Houston, Harold Houston. And I have here a couple. I don't know how many of them I have, but you're welcome to the ones that I do have. And this is an article I did on Fritz Merrick, which I called Fritz Merrick, Parkersburg with a Rebel with a Cause. And I think you might enjoy it because it really does give you an insight into how a local socialist group worked and their strategies and what have you. And some of the stuff that they really do get me. Houston and Merrick would ride around in a carriage on Sundays in Parkersburg looking for a crowd. So they might see a bunch of people out on a Sunday picnic, Sunday school picnic, or, you know, a dinner on the ground type situation. Well, they'd never pass that up. They would go over there and start talking to them about socialism. Well, you can imagine how many fights they got into, which was a constant hazardous thing. But what cracked me up was the fact that they did it at all, and that they did it quite regularly. In some cases, you have local people who will, local parties, local branches, as they would tend to call them, of the Socialist Party, they would hire a hall. They would get either a local speaker, a statewide speaker, or they would get a national speaker. Some of the state people that they would get, Edward Kintzer from Clarksburg, he was on this, what I would call the circuit. He would go out and make speeches. Very, very excellent guy. Valentine Ruther, the father of Walter Ruther, would be on this circuit and was a very, very effective speaker. Let's see who else I have. Well, then of course you'd have national people too. Mostly Victor Berger. We've got the National Socialist Parties from New Jersey somehow come down here. Mr. O'Hare and his wife, both socialists, came down into West Virginia quite frequently. George Goebel, it's not the comedian, this is George Goebel, another New Jersey socialist that came in quite often. But as the party matures, these are really things worth going to. they would often draw as much, if you can believe the newspapers, crowds of 3,000 and 4,000 people would come to hear these people speak. Here again, West Virginia need more entertainment, even historically, okay? And some of the descriptions are really, really quite interesting. They would meet the speaker down at the railroad station, the local people who were going to greet them, all of them, they would be dressed up with the red, red ribbon, huge ribbon across their chest, tie over here, red carnation in their buttonhole, to escort the speaker to the dais, wherever it might be, out in the baseball field or in the hall or whatever it might be, and usually followed by a small band which would play music for our honored guest, and away we went. So you could be part of that. In fact, there are several historians of the socialist movement that said that if as many people voted for the Socialist Party as attended these big hoopla's, they would have control of the country. I don't think so, but nonetheless, they probably do have a point. So these were very important deals, and there were converts made. In some instances, this is almost like revival meetings. So that's what it puts me in mind of. You'd have a meeting, the speaker would come up there and harangue the audience, persuade the audience, and so on and so forth. And then he would say, as part of his speech, now, all of you who will be interested in joining this great effort, this great movement, come up. I'm going to stay here as long as anybody will come. Well, you know, I've heard preachers say that same thing, haven't you? At revivals, I'll be here as long as anybody wants to accept the Lord. And anybody wants to accept Mark, so you come right up here now, and I'll give my blessing to you, and so on. I think that's kind of neat, and you might have been converted that way. I don't know. You may have gone wild. You know, girls gone wild, join the Socialist Party. Okay? All right. Well, the other, fourth thing that I want to mention is that socialists, of course, believe this, that if you work to build unions, and that's what you, that should be one of your major goals. Work to build unions, because if you do that, you eventually will create a much more powerful socialist movement. By the very fact of joining a union, a worker or an individual has taken that first step into understanding the idea of we versus them. That we, the individuals, that's what we have. We have our labor power, and that power can be mobilized if we would but get together, see. So you will see them as some of the most vigorous organizers, in extremely, how would I want to put this, in positions of leadership far beyond the number of folks whom they actually represent. Is that a fair way to say it? Because they were good, dedicated, and effective people. Just to give you some idea, if you go down through the various levels of union organization, and I won't do that because I don't have time, number one, and number two, it's in this book. Buy this book. I know it's expensive. I really think it is. I wish it was half the price of it. But if you do, I get a little cut up. They already owe me $158, so could we get that up to $200? You can do it, but in there you will see, in the back, Appendix A, back there, it gives you the socialist leadership, and if you run down through that, you will see how many of them were in key offices in like the State Federation of Labor, the Ohio Valley Trades and Labor Assembly, the Huntington Trades and Labor Council, Marion County, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, whatever, and there we are, okay? So, trade unionism, that's one of their major, major goals. Finally, I just want to mentioned this to you, and I'm going to cut it a little bit short because I see a lot of you already dropping off. And, we can't have that. So, but I think the whole question now is, well, did it work? That should be a question you ask. You see, some of you have had before, and you've heard this before, but it's true. But one of the great things about being a teacher is that you really are, at least the way I taught the old-fashioned way, you are the boss. Okay, you run the whole show. And it's just great because you can ask questions, and then if nobody answers quickly enough, you can answer the questions. And you can just show how smart you are and say, you know, oh, don't you know that? If you don't have the blah, 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 you see, you know. And I just have a great fun doing that. In fact, I tell my students, if we didn't need the tuition money, I wouldn't need you at all. I could just ask myself questions, you know, just as smart as all get out, and there we go. But I will ask you this question, since the issue comes up, because what I'm saying is, does it work? You know, did it work? Did these various methods of trying to reach the public and these sacrifices and so on and so forth, did they work? That has been asked me a number of times. I used to love to interview people who were what I call non-structured interview subjects. You know, you interview somebody, they're either the same as the jury, witnesses before a jury. Some people you can interview them, and you have to just milk the information out of them. You have to structure an interview and ask them a question. Well, did you go to work? Tell me about going to work. Well, I went to work Saturday. Well, what time did you go? You don't tell you any of that information. Just answer your questions. And other people, you can say, did you go to work? And you can sit back and smoke a cigarette, eat an ice cream cone, whatever. And they will just go on and on and on and on. You don't have to ask any more questions. Pretty soon, they're up about complaining about Social Security. They went all the way through their life. And there they are. And one of the best for that was an old guy who used to be a Charleston policeman. But before that, he'd been a glass worker, lived up on the West Side Hill, named George Villain. And I just didn't realize what a jabberbox he was. And so I started. He was a very good subject. And I said, George, can you tell me about when you first went to work in a glass factory? Sure. And he goes, you know, he can tell you he's about 80 years old, and he could, which is reach. But anyway, he would tell you the day he went, what the weather was like, who was there, how much he got paid. I mean, you would be amazed how much memory these people would have. And he would yabber and jabber and talk, and he'd say, oh, he said, now, you know, maybe talking about how they made the glass and all, he said, now, you're probably wondering about. And I thought to myself, no, I'm not wondering about it a bit, but I should be. You know what I mean? He knew the question. And so he would ask the question and answer it. I don't know. Structure with pulling in all this. It may have owed as much to George Washington and so on as it does to Karl Marx in some ways. But if you were voting and you decided, I'm not going to vote socialist because they're just not getting enough votes, and why waste my vote on not getting anywhere, but if we wait long enough, this may come around. If you wanted to speed up, even if you did, if you wanted to speed up this, the cooperative commonwealth that we hear Deb's talking about and so on, which would you vote for, Democrats or Republicans in elections? Back then, not today. Back then, anybody have a thought? Who thinks Republicans? You're all right. Why? Considering the socialist movement. So you voted the right vote for the wrong reason. I haven't had too many people do that. I might get your name and address and bring you in next class. Here's a guy who's tried to straighten out. Why Republican? Why did you vote Republican?
Because I
the Republican Party started out as the party of the workers with Lincoln. And then it did, you had Thomas, I mean, you had Roosevelt, you know, Teddy Roosevelt, which was a very socialist thinking person. And so that, at that point in time, they were probably...
That's what he's saying, in a way, I mean, you know, it's pro, kind of pro-labor. They really were. I mean, the workers voted Republican here in the state. The Republicans were in ascendancy during this period. And the voters voted for them. Why? Why did they vote for them? Well, look, the Republicans are more capitalistic than the Democrats, actually.
Yeah.
Then and now. Okay, am I right?
Yeah.
Then and now, okay? So, here's the point. Like according to Marx, if we have one change, one system supplanting another system, you know, a system that's Hegelian, the system develops and by its very inconsistencies and weaknesses, it generates a new system. That new system, right, comes on and takes over and generates an antithesis and so on and so forth, okay? Well, if you vote for Republicans, the capitalistic system is going to mature much more quickly and create more inconsistencies more quickly, and therefore the uprising will come, and you won't have to worry about it as a socialist. They'll probably storm the Bastille or the United States Steel Plant or whatever it might be, and away we go. Okay? You see that?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, the point is, this was working. Socialists were really gaining power. And one could see that from, especially from about 1910 through 1914 here in West Virginia. In 1912, that election, the socialists get, now this won't impress you very much, they get at least 15,000 votes in West Virginia. We have some voting returns here that you can pick up and take with you if you'd like to see some proof of these matters. And that was about 6%, roughly 6% of the West Virginia electorate of that time. We're not a big population state, you understand that, of course. Never have been. We're getting close to about the population we had at the turn of the century, it seems to me, but this is what it was like. So this was just almost exactly the same percentage that Debs, who was running for president at that time, got nationally. All right? Well, that doesn't knock your socks off. I can see that. And it doesn't. But this might. We had, in certain areas, much higher percentage of votes for local socialists for office and put them in office. Okay? In my opinion, these votes come from two general areas, if you will, two areas of the state. Number one, they come from the coal fields. Now, a lot of people say, well, the main reason for that is we had this big strike in 1912. The election is November, the strike is really picking up steam in September. So there is a strike during the what I would call campaign period. We didn't, like today, we didn't campaign all year long. We had a relatively short actual campaign period, mostly for the month of September and October. And then we voted, okay? So what you really have there is a situation where in 1912 in Kanawha County, as I had mentioned in the very beginning, the socialists carry the magisterial district of Paint Creek and Cabin Creek. But they also carry the magisterial district called the Falls District of Fayette County. Now you know the Falls District, you just don't know you know. But it's up Kanawha Falls. Okay, what is that? What place is that? Golly Bridge, on up the Golly River, on up the New River, Boomer, exactly right, up that north side of the Kanawha River, all that area goes socialist as well. This means constables, this means boards of education, this means county commissioners, probably means control of the liquor business, because the liquor was not controlled by the state in these days, it was controlled by the counties. The counties gave permission, that's why there's a lot of patronage, political patronage up there, and that's why some people get killed over, like the Jerome brothers in Boomer, who got killed because they tried to sell beer when they had not been given the permission by the Fayette County Board, County Commission, as it were, of the day. So you have a lot of them. This is also reflected, it seems to me, in the leadership of the mine districts at this time. District 29, for instance, was created, which just was expanded recently, it was created in 1913. All of those first leaders, particularly, were socialists, but one. Okay, but one. L.C. Rogers was the president of the district, and Zeb Campbell, Lawrence Peggy Dwyer, one-legged guy, and so on and so on. Henry Grounds from right near Montgomery, et cetera, et cetera. And the only thing that kept the UMWA District 17, which is a big district, from having socialists, was the fact that the national organization poured a fair amount of money and support in there to keep more conservative people in, but they were ousted finally by a fellow you probably have come across in your reading, Frank Heaney, Fred Mooney, and that whole bunch of folks who were, almost all of them were socialists, okay. All right, so we have in mind communities, and interestingly enough, we have the socialists doing very, very well in what I would call small working class towns. And my own opinion is, and this is probably full of baloney, but this is what I'm thinking about this after pondering it many years. If you look at what makes them susceptible is, they're like coal mining towns in this sense. They only have about one industry. See? And when you only have one industry in a town, there's a much greater tendency for you to really think much more in terms of we versus they. First place, there's no alternative employment for you in a lot of these towns. You're either a glass worker, or a steel worker, or a pottery worker, or whatever it is, or you ain't nothing. So, you have to fight, you can't flee. You can't get another job very readily. And I think that in some towns, especially with the infusion of a few key radicals, you have an upheaval that's manifest at this time, where the whole government is elected as socialist. The best article on that is by a professor at Wesleyan University up in Buchanan, Stephen Cresswell, Stephen Cresswell, and his article is called When the Socialists Ran Star City. A great town to pick. I meant to do that, and I was too lazy, never did do it, and you know, I really am sort of PO'd at that guy for beating me to it, but he did a wonderful, wonderful job on it. And I recommend it to you. I brought one of the article here, but it's in West Virginia History, and these good people at the archives can put it in your hands, and I urge you to read it because it really gives an insight, as does Fritz Merrick, the article I wrote, on how a local socialist organization works, all right? The thing of it is, by 1916, it's all over. It's pretty much all over. Socialists are back to about where they were in 1904. In pretty bad shape. Nonetheless, they have, it seems to me, had a big impact. Just take politics real quick for an example. One of the things that I think they do politically is to shake up the Republican establishment. Probably more socialists were drawn from the Republican Party, as you have pointed out, because they see them as more that's more sympathetic to the working people because of the protective tariff as much as anything else. So, you know, there they are, leaving the wings of the Republican Party and going over to the Socialist, albeit temporarily. What does that message does that send? Well, it sends a message, these people may be up for grabs again, if you will really pay attention to them, and if you start to meet their interest. So what the Democrats tend to talk more about is the ability for you fellows to form a union rather than be protected by the protective tariff. And ultimately, I think that's the argument that wins more and more of them to the Democratic cause. So that, and this idea, they may have been planted some, at least at the time, that's why I love this period. America's still very plastic. It's not frozen. There's still seemingly an open window for experimentation, for rethinking our system, for trying to see if we can't do better. And that working men talk about this and understand this a bit and participate, I think makes this whole movement worth studying by just about anybody. I appreciate your attention. I'll take any questions if time permits. What happened in 1914? Okay, the question is, why did it collapse? Never mind the date, actually, but you know, I get you. What happened? A lot of things happened. If I have to pick out one or two that are very important, it would be this. The number one thing that I feel disrupted the party here was the First World War. World War I did a tremendous amount to disrupt the party. Why? Because the party's initial reaction to the war was, we're in it. See, this is a capitalist war and a working men's fight. And we ought not to be doing it. But here's the problem with that. One of the appeals that the Socialist Party had for the American working men in West Virginia, and I suspect in a lot of other states as well, is this. It seemed acceptable, an acceptable idea, because it fit within the American idea of what society should be like. I'm not saying that well. They really couched their arguments as much in American history as they did in Marx. See, and I'll give you a quick example. The Constitution. The Socialists believed that the Constitution, the United States Constitution, the Socialists, many of them believed the Constitution was a counter-revolutionary step. What America really had going for it, you saw during the Articles of Confederation, when the central government was very weak, and the local governments were very strong, and democracy was possible then because the government was decentralized. But these guys, most of whom had bonds in projects of the government, eventually, so says one of the great historians of American history, Charlie Beard, put the Constitution in to strengthen it so that it could pay off those bonds, so it could promote industrialism, so it could do all the things that would make us a first-rate power. Are you following this? So what's amazing about that, or should be to historians or students of history, is that argument they were raising in 1911 and 1912. But Beard doesn't write till 1913. They're Beardian before Beard. This is amazing. That was their vision, you see. So, the kind of problem is that they hearken back to the American Revolution a lot, and to the idea of that there was a working class kind of involvement. They loved the Boston Massacre deal. Okay, here's workers. It was workers, soldiers that that fought the revolution and so on, so see, and so on and so forth. So really, to a certain extent, they preached ideas that would be acceptable to anyone who knew his American history or her American history. So what I think happened in this time was, even though they, you know, officially they went against, were against the war, their patriotism came back to haunt them. What I tell my students when I'm teaching this, I say, live by the flag, die by the flag. To me, that's one of the most important things. Second important issue, but I don't feel it's as important as that one, is the Socialist Party split in 1912. It split into the red faction, which believed not in politics so much, but in direct action, strikes, etc., and the yellow faction, which is the old faction we've pretty much described here, who believed in gradual political action, gradual reforms, and so on. The red, the guys that believed in direct action, they're called the reds. The people that believed in indirect action, they're called the yellows, or the socialists. The socialists versus the socialists who, as some of us, the yellow socialists said, are exceeding the speed limit. Socialists exceeding the speed limit. There are other factors which bear upon the issue, but I believe if you think about those two, that may answer your question, at least in part. Most of the big ones. Yeah.
Dr. Barkey.
Yeah.
I was just curious, because there were two splits in the Socialist Party. It was 1912, and 1919 also there was a national split, and it had to do, it was the formation of the Communist Party because of the support of the Bolshevik Revolution in Russia in 1917. It was also more internationalist, whereas a lot of the socialists were isolationists. In their opposition to the war, it wasn't just because it was a capitalist war. There were some of the Socialist Party because they were simply isolationists, which other people weren't socialists for as well.
That's a good point, yeah.
But the Communist Party was internationalist. It was like not loyal to the country, but to their working mm-hmm. class internationally. Also more anti-racist, taking more, you know, the national question that Lenin wrote about. I was just curious in your research if you found any of the leaders of the Socialist Party in West Virginia, if they immediately jumped to the Communist Party.
I don't know the answer. See, I went up to 1920. I just had not researched that. I tried to get things pulled into research that.
Well, a point to that, there's another Socialist Party based out of Charleston. It was a daily paper run by the Communist Party. It was the Labor's Daily, which another really good book. Not as good as yours, but it's when miners marched, but it's written in articles from that paper.
Yeah. Well, they,
they're both good, I'll just try.
Yeah. Well, thank you for that. You do have a copy of this book?
Yes, I'll
have it. He's put it at $158. Thank you very much. Appreciate you. Your comment on that. Anything else? Yeah?
Let me just stand up. If you weren't a socialist in the period you were studying, how much did you know about the socialist movement from the mainstream media? This, of course, was a period of Hearst and Pulitzer, the major newspaper chains, and I assume the socialist newspapers had relatively small circulations. So if you were outside these communities in West Virginia or anywhere else, you know, were the Hearst papers, the Pulitzer papers, covering the socialist movement to any degree?
Somewhat,
and
yes.
And if so, how were they covering it?
Well, yeah. One of the main papers, for instance, in New York was the New York Call,
yeah,
which covered it pretty thoroughly. And of course, I think they covered it from the, not a necessarily a nuanced coverage of it, it seems to me, but we had all sorts of reporters in here from time to time with this. And I'm not sure exactly how they were connected and who were their contacts in here to talk to get some of this stuff. But I don't want to say superficially, I don't believe, but I think certainly more superficially than the local papers did. But the major facts, it seems to me, they got right, near as I can tell. I'll tell you who would probably have known that. Unfortunately, she's dead. But Lois McLean tried to collect all of those papers. And we probably have them. We, the Labor History Association, turned them over to the archives here. Or we haven't yet, have we?
Dick? Yes, yes, they are.
Okay, Pat.
Recognizing the significant impact that this movement has, you say it died out in 1960, but have you explored the legacy and what it is today, what impact the, what you see today that reflects on it?
You mean why? Do I look at them again today?
Well, surely it could, I know you say it died down, but surely it left. There's
got to
be residual thinking.
Oh, there is. One can see it, for instance, in the 20s, when you have a revolt in the United Mine Workers itself, led by our friend Mr. Keeney, and based mostly on Kelly's Creek. They are really, you know, very much involved in continuing, hopefully continuing the socialist approach, but it's still a little bit of a confusion in my mind whether they are more akin to the red side of the situation or the yellow side of the situation. Obviously, they're not much into the politics, although Mr. Keeney gives a number of speeches saying, you have got to educate yourself, you have got to be involved in political activities as well as economic activities, because if you're eventually going to run society, you need to have those experiences. So I would tend to say both, but my gut feeling about the whole business is that the whole movement at that time, I believe, is much more direct action oriented than it is. You know, it's more left wing. Because red socialists were sometimes what we call industrial socialists. You don't organize by the old trades. Most of the yellow socialists in the mainstream of the old Socialist Party were skilled workers. You can see that in the elections. If you look and see what jobs the Socialist Party candidates have, like in a city like Star City, for instance, all the socialists are glassblowers there. Okay. And the other party people are generally a clerk, a guy who runs a store, small business people. It's a small town anyway, okay? And not really skilled workers at all. And yet Star City, in the later years, in the early 20s, very much influenced by the direct action. And I think that also backs them away a bit from politics. You see, your industrial unionists, they do really leave a heritage here. And I'll give you a good example of that, which is not known to most people, but West Virginia is the first state where the labor movement in the 1930s completely leaves the AFL and joins the CIO. So this whole idea of industrial unionism and direct action, i.e. strikes, is really their mantra, their watchword. And that certainly comes from the late 1919, 1920, and so on. See, the thing about it is, the difference is, sometimes it's very confusing because most people think, wait a minute, industrial unions, you're talking John L. Lewis. See, and he was anything but a socialist. But what Lewis believed is in his industrial union, the structure, not the process. Now, there's two qualities the old social, red socialists talked about. One is the direct action, which is the strike. The other is democracy within the trade union itself. Lewis was a genius in this sense. he promulgated and pushed the strike and the structure, but not the process, not the democratic process. In fact, it was the opposite way. He wanted to run like a dictatorship, like he was the general, generalissimo, and these other people were the soldiers. And when the general says, get out of the trenches and charge in, you better do it. Okay. Or our non-coms bash you in the head or do whatever to you. But just for your information, I think there is that residual thing you're talking about. Very definitely. It's a good question. Anything else? Well, we're supposed to leave, and if I'll wait for you up here as long as anybody wants to be converted.